Hey guys, you're back once again with the Renegade Master.
Disclaimer, I'm not actually the Renegade Master.
This is beginnerdjlessons.com and I'm Phil. And in this week's video, I'm going to show you five of the most common ways to mix between two songs that are different speed. Just quickly explain something to you. Speed, BPM or beats per minute, and tempo all refer to how fast a song is. So we're going to be teaching you today five of the most common ways to mix two songs of different speed, BPM, tempo. Let's get into it. Okay guys, so there's loads of different types of DJs. There's certain DJs that will never skip from a faster song to a slower song. They'll gradually move their way in and out and make sure all their DJ sets are meticulous. I'm not that kind of DJ. I'm the kind of DJ who likes to just play bangers that come into my head that I think the crowd are going to enjoy. If you're anything like me and you just want to play music that's going to get the crowd going, every now and again you're going to have to go from two different songs that are just completely different speeds. And I'm going to show you the different ways to do it. I'm going to start off with the easiest things, easiest ways to do it, which are incredibly basic, but they make up 90% of the way I tend to do this. And I'm going to move on to a couple more, slightly more creative ways to do it that are more difficult. And I'd love to say they're more impressive, but my opinion of DJing is that most people who are dancing to your music are usually drunk and they're having a laugh with their friends. They're not all standing there listening out for every single mix you do. And even if they were listening out, they probably wouldn't really know what you were doing half the time. So as much as I want to say the more technical ways of doing this are more impressive, they may be impressive to other DJs, but they're not really impressive to the crowd of people you're playing to. Now that's a very controversial thing to say, and I know there's a load of DJs out there who are probably seething over the fact that I suggest that people don't realize every single thing a DJ is doing behind the decks. But the reality is, guys, I've played at so many weddings, functions, clubs, and the people out there are not really aware of what you're doing here, but they will be aware if you make it sound terrible. Which is why I like to do the easiest things possible and not do stuff too technical, because the technical stuff could lead to you messing up, and that's when they'll become aware of you messing up. Rant over. Let's get into it. So I've got two songs here. The first one is called I'm On Fire, and it sounds a bit like this. It's 126 BPM. Little tip for you guys, if you're going to go from a fast song to a slow song, it's always good to go into a slower song that everybody, without fail, will know. Because people won't care that you're going from a faster song to a slow song if you're putting on a banger that everyone knows about. I just randomly went through my playlist and picked a slower song that I know everybody knows, and I've got Dirty by Christina Aguilera.
Haters gonna hate.
I'd listen to it and I'd pick out the bit that I knew everyone was going to react to. So for example, the song starts like this. And I'm like, I don't want to come in with that because not everyone's going to know what that is. However, if you fast forward a bit, you'll get to this bit. You ain't here to party! Now it's important you guys kind of know that because it's a really vital part of DJing. You want to get to the part of the song that people know about. Play it again. If I go from the beginning. Awkward. No one knows what this song is yet. And you've just gone from an absolute banger. And you've just suddenly gone into this. See what I mean? Moments like that are the thing that are going to make your audience go, what's the DJ doing? What the hell is he playing? And you don't want that. So you go to the part of the song you know everyone's going to react to. So here we go. I wait till the drop of song A ends. Now most drops end with a kind of whooshing noise, like boom. So half your work is done. Let me show you, okay? That's not the end of the song, it's just the end of the drop. Watch, it comes back in now. Half your work's done for you there, guys. The drop ends and it goes boom. That's exactly when you're bringing track B. You ain't here to party. Ladies, move. Move. And you've just gone from a song that's 125 beats per minute to a song that is 100 beats per minute. That's quite a big jump. No one will think anything of it. Now, that is what I do most of the time. Wait for the drop to end. I pick an amazing track or a really song that everyone knows. Just bring it straight in. Okay, guys, so here's another slight variation of what I just did then. You essentially let the track one come to an end and then press play on track two. So you want to use the same principles I was just telling you about a second ago with picking a very popular second song. But what we're going to do this time is do what I call a whip back, where you essentially put your hand on the decks and whip it back, which makes this kind of sound, and then you hit play. It's a bit more attention grabbing, this. It's like saying, hey everybody, because everyone will kind of be aware, oh my god, what the hell's going on? And then you hit track B. And what you've got to do is wait till the track comes to an end, you put your hand on the wheel, and you literally spin it back. After you've whipped it back, you press pause so the song doesn't just start playing again after it's whipped back. And then you hit play over here. You can apply that to any song you want. So, for example, here's a song by the Chainsmokers. It's a Chainsmokers remix of this song. Okay, so the drop ends and it goes straight into talking. But I don't want the talking to be there. Unlike the last song, it doesn't just go after the drop, it goes straight into something. And I don't want that something to be there. So I'm going to do a whip back. You wouldn't do this very often, you may only do it once a night. But it's a cool little trick to have up your sleeve. But I'm more of a DJ who wants to kind of blend into the background than have everybody staring at me. So I wouldn't really throw in those kind of garish moves very often. Now, there's a third thing I want to mention here. With these songs that don't just go boof after the drop, the ones that carry on into something, like the way this drop just goes straight into singing, you can create the same effect as the last track by adding effects and blending out the song. So, this is what you guys want to do. You add a bit of echo to your track, or actually quite a lot of echo, so add it all in up here. Add in quite a lot of reverb, but don't turn them on, okay? When the track comes to an end, so let me go to the bit, as you can see, this is where the drop comes to an end. Exactly here, I'm going to add the two effects that we just put on by just turning them on up here. So when it comes to the end of the drop here, I then turn these two effects on. The track is just going to sound really wide and echoey and boomy. Then what we're going to do is the classic filter off and volume down. I've taught you guys this one so many times. You pinch the filter, you spin it down, and you use this thing here to turn the volume down. There we go, guys. Bit of creativity. You can create these exact effects with your DJ decks. Okay, so a lot of you will recognize this next bit from the last video I did where I deconstructed one of Marshmello's sets. You can take a track that's 70 BPM and play another track that's 140. Or in other words, you can take a track and bring in a second track that's literally double the speed of the first track and overlay them on top of each other and then take away track A. So the two tracks I've got here are Ride by 21 Pilots. Oh, I'm taking my time on my ride. The second track is a Marshmello remix of Oops by Martin Garrix, and it sounds like this. That track is literally double the speed of the first track, give or take. But if you go onto Serato, more often than not, Serato will literally tell you that a 140 BPM track is 71, because their algorithms will sometimes just say it's 71, even if the original is actually 140. That's what I mean. The tracks are very, very similar speed, even though one's double the speed. So first thing you want to do is just make sure the exact same speed on here. So it says 73 and 71, even though we know it's a lot faster than that. So we just make them the same speed. Another thing is, if you're going to lay one track on top of another, you have to make sure they're the same key. So these tracks are 2A and 2A. If you guys don't know about mixing in key, I'll put a link to a video of mine up here somewhere where you can learn all about mixing in key. But all you need to know is make sure that they're in the same key, and you can use a program called Mix in Key for that. So here's the next thing. You can't just lie one track on top of another and hope they're gonna work. You have to do a bit of research here, guys, and listen to the tracks. There's no magic formula for when you need to start playing one track over the other, but here's a tip for you. You want to look for a part of track A, which is primarily vocals. If you can get a very stripped back vocal part of track A, and then on track B, find a very stripped back, just instrumental part. When I say stripped back, I mean there's not much going on but vocals, or not much going on but a basic instrumental part. Okay, then you can lay them on top of each other so it sounds like there's vocals sitting on top of an instrumental part of the song. If you can find those and lay them on top of each other, that would be the perfect time to lie one track on top of the other. So let me show you what I'm talking about. In track A, I found this part of the song where it goes from a rap to a very stripped back vocal. Let's listen to it. And then it goes into this. See, there's not much going on there other than the vocals and like a there's just like an instrumental part that's just very simple. Then on the second track, I found an instrumental part with no vocals. It's also very stripped back. So if you play the two at the same time, it'll sound like vocals are sitting on top of instrumentals, okay? So I know in this track, the rap, kind of the more instrumental bit, ends here, and then it goes into the more stripped back vocals. So as soon as it gets to this point here, I'm pressing play to the instrumentals on track B, okay? Now, in order to make sure it's not too busy, as soon as I hit play on track B, so you've got the instrumentals playing, I'm going to take away a lot of the bass in track A. Taking away a lot of the bass will leave more of the vocals. So let me show you, okay? Do you see what I mean? I've taken it away. It sounds thinner, but it puts more emphasis on the vocals. The reason for this is because the vocals sit in the higher frequency range and not the lower bassy range. So by taking away the bass completely, it puts more emphasis on the higher frequencies, which is the vocals, which will work really nicely when I bring in those chords. And then I'll slowly filter out the rest of the vocals of track A. I hope this makes sense. I'm going to show you what I'm talking about now. And then we're into track B. Basically, it's a lot of preliminary work of finding out what will work with two separate songs. Once you've found them and you've practiced, feel free to go ahead and play it live. Again, don't want to keep repeating myself, but as soon as you start making it more complicated for yourself, there's more chances it can go wrong, which is why I don't tend to do more complicated stuff like this. Okay, so there's one last thing I find myself doing quite a lot. Mixing one dance track that's about 125 BPM into a dance track that's more like 130. Now, these two tracks are so close, what you can do is just bring them to meet each other halfway. So you'd move the 125 BPM up to 127, and you'd move the 130 BPM down to 127, and you can go from there. But there's a slightly more fun way to do this, and that is to sync the two tracks up. Once you sync them up, as soon as you press play, they'll automatically kind of sync in with each other. But the reason why I like using this is because as soon as you start using the tempo to speed or slow the tracks up, both the track tempos will speed up or slow down at the same time. Which means you can beat match at a slower BPM and then move the track up to a higher BPM and the two tracks will be beat matched at the same time, so it sounds quite cool. It's like you're taking people with you to that higher BPM and it sounds quite cool, okay? Now, this next technique is going to involve a bit of beat matching. So if you don't know how to beat match, go and check out my course at beginnerdjlessons.com or watch this video above me here, which will kind of give you an introduction to beat matching. If I'm playing this track over here, that's 125 BPM, and I want to sync this track to this track, I hit the sync button on this side and it will sync this track to this track, okay? So this track's 125, this is 130. You can see 125, 130. If I hit the sync button here, watch what happens. Boom, they both went to 125. Now, when I take the tempo slider here and slide it up or down, watch what happens over here. They both move up or down at the same time. That's really cool. It's good fun, okay? So, I'm gonna beat match with both volume sliders all the way up. It's not gonna sound perfect, but I just want you guys to see everything I'm doing, okay? So, I'm gonna beat match them. I'm gonna start taking away some of track A, but I'm also gonna be speeding it up. Let's do it. Okay guys, I hope you enjoyed this video. In this video I showed you all the different ways that I would go between different BPMs of songs, and I showed you the most common ways I do it and a few more creative ways. There are of course other ways you can do this. These are the top 5 ways I would do it as a DJ if I was DJing live. So I hope they help you. Guys, if this video has been of help to you, make sure to give it a like. The more likes the video gets, the more views it gets. And that's what I want to happen. If you've got a comment, make sure you leave it below. I'd love to hear from you guys. And remember, as per usual, if you guys don't know what anything on these DJ decks do and you want to learn how to DJ, make sure you visit my site at beginnerdjlessons.com, where I will teach you everything you need to know about doing your first DJ gig. Finally guys, if you haven't already, make sure you subscribe to this channel for more videos and more content coming out soon. Thanks for watching guys, see you guys next time. Bye!